questions, I hope I'm audible to all. Can you confirm I'm audible to all?
Your voice is breaking a little bit.
I'm unable to hear you properly. Please confirm.
Your voice is breaking a little bit.
Yeah, sir.
Okay, I hope the connection will be stable. So I'm going to share the slide now. Okay. Is the slide visible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So today we are going to discuss experiment number 3 in data lab. And this is to plot of RLC series AC circuit. Okay. This is the RLC series AC circuit. So we have studied in our previous about RL and RC series circuits. Before that, we have seen the first experiment, which is time constant for an RC circuit. So in that RC, first experiment was for DC excitation. Last experiment was RL and RC for AC excitation. And we have seen what is power, power factor, how do you find out what is the choke inductance and capacitance value from the various measures. In this experiment, we are going to study another phenomena for these RLC, because everything in electrical engineering revolves around inductor, capacitor and resistance and their properties. So we are going to study a phenomena which is very famous, and you might have already studied this also in brief, the phenomena of resonance. So what is resonance? And we'll be discussing about series resonance here. I'll tell you about what is parallel resonance also, but we will mainly focus on series resonance in as part of your experiment. So what is the definition of series resonance? When do we say that the system is in resonance? An RLC series circuit is in resonance. So RLC series circuit is in resonance when the current flowing through the circuit is in phase, okay, is in phase with the applied voltage. So you can see here from this portion, the current is in phase to the applied voltage. We say that RLC series circuit is in resonance condition. Now, when do you say that a current and a voltage are in phase? When do you say that current and voltage are in phase? Can anyone tell?
When X equals to XL.
Yeah. So whenever we are talking about a resistive circuit, in that case, we say that the current flowing through the element is in phase to that of the voltage applied across the element. So during resonance condition, if the current is in phase with the voltage, that means that even though it's an RLC series circuit, the system is actually behaving as that of a pure resistor. And how is that possible? That is possible because the inductive reactance is equal to the capacitive.
Sir, your voice is breaking.
Capacitive reactance. Yes, what happened?
Sir, your voice is breaking.
Yes, sir.
My voice is breaking. Is it for everyone or only for a few students?
Yes, sir. For everyone.
Everyone.
Is it okay? So let me check the connection once again. Just hold. Okay, is the sound audible to everyone now? Is it much clearer?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
So, yeah. So, whenever the inductive reactants, we have seen what is an inductive reactance, that is XL. Okay, that is equal to the capacitive reactance. What will happen? These two reactances, they are equal. That means, what will happen in that particular case? I into XL will be equal to I into XC. We call that situation as series resonance condition. And the frequency at which this happens, we call that as the resonance frequency. Okay. Now, next. So consider this RLC series circuit here. Okay, it is excited by a voltage source. It's an AC voltage source. What is the inductive reactance? Inductive reactance XL is equal to 2 pi F into L, where 2 pi F is nothing but omega multiplied by L. And capacitive reactance XC can be written as 1 by omega C, which is 1 by 2 pi F C. Okay, this we had seen in the previous session also. That is inductive reactance and capacitive reactance. Now, whenever you are having a series circuit, there will be some resistance, some inductive reactance and capacitive reactance. And we should tell by the value of these inductors, capacitors, resistors in the circuit, how is the system actually behaving? How is the circuit actually behaving? So it will depend upon whether the circuit has more amount of inductive reactance when compared to the capacitive reactance. So when XL value, the inductive reactance, is greater than that of the capacitive reactance, we call the system or the circuit to be an inductive circuit. The circuit is an inductive circuit. And whenever the capacitive reactance XC is greater than the inductive reactance, we call the circuit to be capacitive in nature. Fine. Now, when we say that system is inductive, what does that mean? For an inductor, we had seen the property. What was the property last time we had seen? For a pure inductor, what is the relationship between current and voltage?
The current lags behind voltage by 5/2.
You are very low voice. Okay. Roll number 28, I am not able to hear what you're saying.
And I'm saying the current lags behind voltage in an inductor, sir.
Yes, current lags in an inductor, the current lags the voltage by 90 degree. That is for a pure inductor. Now, if I have R and L together, as in the previous case, if we are having R and L together in series, then what will we say? We can say that the angle will not be exactly 90 degree between current and voltage. It will be somewhat less than 90 degree, between 0 to 90 degrees, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And when we say it's a capacitive circuit, we know that current actually leads the voltage by 90 degrees. Isn't it? Current leads the voltage by 90 degree. Now this reactance, the capacitive reactance and inductive reactance, they both are opposite to each other. When you say opposite to each other, are they some vector quantities? No, these are not vector quantities. These are XL and XC, they both are normal values depending upon the inductor and the frequency. Similarly, capacitor and the frequency value. So depending upon these values, XL and XC will be varying. Now, why do we say that total reactance? Here you can see it is written XT is equal to XL minus XC or XC minus XL. Why do we say that? Yeah. Can anyone
so
tell
that's
me?
Because capacitive reactants will, in case of capacitive reactants, the phase difference would be making the circuit more like the voltage would lead instead of current in case of capacitive reactants, and in case of inductive reactants, the current will lag. So they are like opposing
yes.
each other in a way. That's why we subtract.
So they why will they oppose each other? Like since you said the reason is correct that they are.
Sir, your voice is not audible.
Yes,
we confirm that I'm audible to you now. Now the sound is. Yeah. Okay. So I have changed the system actually. Now let us see. I was talking about the total circuit reactance, right? So if I just take this, okay, an RLC series circuit, total circuit reactance XT is XL minus XE or XE minus XL. Now, why do we say, I told you that it is XL minus XE or XE minus XL? Why? Because let me just take to this note here. So I'm going to draw this circuit here. This is an R, is an L, and there is a capacitance, right? Now this is connected to an AC source. This is R, L, and C. Now, because of which there'll be some current flowing through this. Let me say the current is I and the voltage is VS, source voltage. Now, because of this current flow, we know that there'll be some voltage across this resistance. This will be a phasor. Current is also a phasor. VS is also a phasor. Because of which there will be some voltage across the inductor, VL phasor, and voltage across the capacitor, VC phasor. So there will be a voltage VR, VL, and this is VC. Now if you write down, what is VR? VR is nothing but I into R, isn't it? And what is VL? We had seen in the last session also, what is VL? VL is the current flowing through the inductor multiplied by the inductive reactance XL, but current is a phasor here. That would mean that current is in the phase, same phase as that of the this voltage. So this expression is actually incomplete. To make it incomplete, we had used, what did we use in the last session? Everyone remembers? We had seen, we had used a J operator, where what is the J operator? Magnitude of J is equal to 1 and angle of J is equal to 90 degrees. That means whenever, what is this J vector, J value? If let's say you are having a phasor A, okay, in this direction, and if you multiply it by J, it will not change its magnitude, but it will rotate it by an angle of 90 degree in the counterclockwise direction. So if I'm having J times A, so J times A will be a phasor 90 degree rotated in the counterclockwise direction. That is the operator J. So since voltage across the inductor and current through the inductor have a 90 degree relationship, where current lags the voltage, that means voltage will be leading the current. That means I can say that it is multiplied by J. So this is the complete expression for the voltage across inductor. This everyone remembers?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So similarly, what will be the voltage across capacitor? I multiplied by XE. But for a capacitor, we know that if this is the current, then current leads the voltage by 90 degree. Here, for an inductor, current lags the voltage by, if this is the current, this is VL, 90 degree. So I into XE, this is incomplete. That means in order to write down VC, VC is actually 90 degree in the counterclockwise, in the clockwise direction. Clockwise direction means we multiply it by minus J. Okay, so VC is nothing but minus J times I into XE. Now, if I write down in this, there's a closed path, isn't it? If it's a closed path, we can write down Kirchhoff's voltage law in this closed path. What is KVL in this loop? KVL in this loop is how much? This will give me VS is equal to R into I plus, what is this VL? Basically, VS is equal to VS is equal to VR plus VL plus VC, where VR is nothing but R into I plus VL is equal to how much? J times I into XL plus VC is minus J times I into XC. Isn't it? Now, if I take I common here, what are you getting here? You are getting I times I phasor times R plus, here J is common, XL minus XC. XL minus XC. So what is this basically telling us? This is telling us that there is a total impedance here. So this is the total impedance Z. I can write down this as I into Z. Vs is equal to I phasor multiplied by Z, where what is Z? Z is equal to R plus J times XL minus XC. So this is the total reactance X. I can write down Z as R plus J times X, where X is the total reactance, is equal to XL minus XC. Is this clear to everyone? So that is why we say that the total reactance is the difference of XL and XC. XL and, you should all remember that XL and XC are not phasors individually, but the voltages are phasors, the currents are phasors, as a result of which the voltages oppose each other, which will lead to the capacitance getting subtracted. So total reactance in the circuit is XL minus XC. Now, whenever there is XL greater than XC, then X is equal to, I can say that this X will be inductive in nature, because XL is greater than XC. That means, what is the meaning of this? That this term is more. That means this is positive. If this is positive, that means VL minus, or this term and this term, sum of these two, is actually behaving as a inductive term, right? So if XL is greater than XC, that means X is positive and the system behaves as inductive. And if XL is less than XC, we say that X is negative and it behaves as a capacitive circuit. I hope that is clear. So in a series circuit, what did we have now? XL and XC, depending upon XL value and XC value, we are having X either greater than X is either positive or negative. Now, if I ask you to plot on the axis here, what is the variation of XL and frequency? Okay, XL and frequency. How will be the variation? We know that XL is equal to omega into L, that is nothing but 2 pi f into L. So as frequency increases, XL will also increase. If f increases, XL will also increase. So the variation will be nothing but a straight line. This is XL is equal to y is equal to mx, where this is y and is equal to 2 pi into L into f. Y is equal to, this is m and this is x, right? Y is equal to mx. Straight line passing through the origin. So this slope is, what is the slope? 2 pi into L. This is the slope. Now if I talk about xc, variation of xc with respect to this. So let me use another color, xc. I want with respect to f. What will be the variation? Xc is nothing but 1 by omega c. That is 1 by 2 pi f into c. That means if my frequency increases, what happens to xc? Xc reduces. So what is this graph? The graph of xc versus f will be something like this. A rectangular hyperbola. Why? Because the equation is, this is y is equal to some constant, that is 1 by 2 pi c into x. So this is nothing but xy is equal to c square. Basically, equation of a rectangular hyperbola. So you will be having a variation like this, xc versus f. Now, as we increase the value of f, let's say we are having a system here. Okay, so this system is having a frequency, let's say f, it is variable. Okay, so if we are increasing or decreasing the frequency from 0 to a higher value, then As you increase the frequency, what will happen? 2 pi f into L, that means inductive reactance will increase and capacitive reactance will start decreasing. At some point here, you can say that the both the capacitive as well as inductive reactance, they become equal, right? At some point, XL becomes equal to XC. That means 2 pi F into L is equal to 1 by 2 pi F into C. That means what is F here? If you cross multiply, F square is equal to 1 by 2 pi whole square into LC. And if you take the root, you'll get 1 by 2 pi root LC. Okay. So at a frequency F, which we know, which we call as the resonant frequency, the inductive reactance and capacitive reactance, they become equal. This frequency is known as the series resonant frequency. And the value is found out by 1 by 2 pi root of LC. Now what happens at this condition when XL becomes equal to XC? So we had seen from the previous equation, what was the equation? Vs was equal to I times R plus J times XL minus XC. Isn't it? This was the equation. Now at F is equal to FR, what will happen to this equation? This equation becomes Vs is equal to I into R plus XL minus XC becomes 0. So this becomes J times 0, or your equation becomes I times R. What does it mean? At resonance, when F is equal to FR, Vs is equal to I into R. That means, what does this mean? That means that your source voltage, okay, source voltage behaves as though the current is flowing through a pure resistance. Source voltage will see that the current is flowing through a pure resistance, even though the system is having an inductor and a capacitor here. The inductive reactance and capacitive reactance are equal, as a result of which the voltage across the inductor and the voltage across the capacitor, these voltages are equal and opposite. They will be equal and opposite, and they cancel out each other, as a result of which the total voltage sum of these two becomes zero. Why? Because let us see VL. What is VL? VL is I into J times I into XL. And what is capacitive voltage? That is minus J times I into XC. Now if XL and XC, they both are equal, then this can be written as minus J times I into XL. Instead of XC, I am writing down XL. At F is equal to FR, resonant frequency. In that particular case, VL plus VC. What will be VL plus VC here? This is J times XL, I into XL. Plus, what is VC now? Minus J times I into XL. This cancels and the sum comes out to be zero. So the sum of these two voltages comes out to be zero. As a result, in KVL equation, Vs is equal to VR plus sum of these two is zero. That means the voltage across the source comes completely across the resistance. In that particular case, what will be the phase? What will be the phase of current? The current will be completely in phase that of the voltage. So if this is Vs, right, what will be the current? The current will also be completely in phase that of the, this is the current I. This will happen only if your system is, your circuit is behaving as a pure resistance. Is this clear to all? Everyone? So at series resonance condition, current is in phase with that of the voltage. Now if I ask you to plot what is the phasor diagram, what will be the phasor diagram here? So again, let me just quickly draw the circuit here. R, L and C, they all are in series and we are exciting it with the voltage source Vs. The current flows through this I. AC quantities, that is why I'm representing them by phases. Phases means by a line on top of it. Now there will be some voltage VR across resistance, across inductor and across capacitor. Now since current is same in all the three elements, I'm going to draw the phasor diagram. Phasor diagram. I'm going to take the reference as the current I. This I have taken as the reference phasor along the x-axis. This is my reference. Okay, this is the reference. Now if my current here is I in this direction, then what is KVL? KVL is Vs is equal to I into R plus J times I into XL plus J times or minus J times I into XC. Isn't it? This is KVL equation in this loop. So this is, if this is I, where will be I into R? I into R will also be in the same direction. I into R in the same direction. Next term here is J times I into XL. So I into XL will be in the direction of I. J times means we rotate it by 90 degree in the counterclockwise direction. So this will be J times I into XL. The third term is minus J times I into XC. I into XC will be in the direction of I. Minus J, if you multiply with that, it will be 90 degree in the counterclockwise direction. So this is 90 degree here through the reference. This is 90 degree in this direction. So in this direction, that is counterclockwise, here it is clockwise. And this will be what? This is VL. And here we'll get what is VC, which is minus J times I into XC. Now, if your system was having XL and XC, they both are same. If XL and XC both are same, then these two terms will get cancelled out each other and Vs will be equal to I into R. But if XL is not equal to XC, let's say general phasor diagram, XL is not equal to XC, and we take the case either XL can be greater than XC or XL can be less than XC. Let us say that XL is greater than XC, then I into XL will be greater than I into XC because I is the same in both the cases, isn't it? So magnitude wise, this phasor magnitude will be greater than the second phasor, downward phasor. And since they are 180 degree out of phase, I can directly subtract them because they are just opposite phases, 180 degree out of phase. So I can say that if this is, this magnitude is I into XL and this magnitude is I into XC, there will be a difference of these two whose magnitude will be J times I into XL minus XC. XL minus XC. Right? This will be the resultant of these two, difference of I into XL and I into XC. And to write down this equation, I into XL minus I into XC, J times plus I into R. So this phasor, I into R plus this resultant phasor will be equal to your Vs phasor. So this is your Vs phasor. So finally, what is the phasor equation, phasor diagram now? You have I into R, okay? And this is the difference, J times I into XL minus XC, because XL is greater than XC. This is on the top, and the sum of these two should be equal to your supply voltage phasor. You can see that there will be an angle which is subtended here, theta or phi. You can call this angle phi, and this is 90 degree. This is the phasor diagram for a general circuit. Now at resonance, what will happen? At F is equal to FR, what will happen? XL is equal to XC. That means the magnitude of this becomes equal to zero. That means what will be the phasor diagram? This is I phasor. In the same direction, you will get I into R phasor, and that will be equal to, that itself will be equal to your resultant voltage phasor, VS. VS phasor will be equal to I phasor into R. So this is your phasor diagram at resonance condition, at series resonance condition. So your circuit behaves as though there is only a pure resistance in the circuit. The capacitive reactance and inductive reactance oppose each other. I hope that is clear. Is this clear to everyone? So this is the series resonance condition. So what can you comment from this? That whatever the term here, the reactive term R plus J times X, Z is equal to R plus J times X. So this X term, the complex coefficient, X is equal to zero here at resonance condition, at F is equal to FR. Why? Because X is nothing but XL minus XC. Now, if I ask you to plot the graph, okay, we have plotted a graph between, so now it is a big graph which I'm going to plot here. I'm plotting here XL versus F. So we have seen that graph is a linear graph. And what do we have the equation here? The equation is VS is equal to I into Z, where Z is equal to R plus J times XL minus XC. Now with respect to F, we need to see the variation. Okay, so if this is XL with respect to frequency, what is XC with respect to frequency? We have already seen this is XC with respect to frequency. We have seen this is XC with respect to frequency, and this is the resonance point FR. But what do we want? We want XL minus XC. So this is XL, this is XL, okay, this is XL, and this is XC. We want XL minus of XC. We have to subtract these two. So if this is XC, then where will be minus XC? If this is XC, then minus XC will be in this direction. Something like this. Just the mirror image of this. This will be nothing but minus of XC with respect to F. Isn't it? And what do we want? We want this, these two to be added. XL plus minus of XC. We want to add these two together. We are adding these two together. Okay, so I am going to remove XC now from the circuit here. I am only having here XL and minus XC, and I am going to add these two together. So what will happen? Because at the end, what we want is this term plus R, but that will give me what is Z. Okay. Now this is minus XC, and as the frequencies are lower, at low frequencies, we can see that this term is very, very high. That means very, very high in negative value, and this is zero or very small. So sum of these two, what will it be? Very, very negative high value, right? So at very low frequencies, the sum of these two will be equal to, X will be equal to how much? negative infinity. Negative, because this is very high value, isn't it? Negative very high value. And at very high frequencies, at very high frequencies, very high frequencies means till this point, this will almost become equal to zero. Very high frequency means this is infinity. Here it was zero. Infinite frequency, XE will be 1 by infinity, that is zero, and XL will be infinity. So this will make that X goes to plus infinity. So you can see that X value varies with respect to frequency from minus infinity to plus infinity. So that means between somewhere, when we vary the frequency, there is some reduction in the value of X. Right? So as we increase the frequency from zero, and as we reach FR, what happens? If I'm plotting here now, X, X is equal to XL minus XE, right? X is equal to XL minus XE. So in that particular case, what will happen? This value will be the difference of these two waveforms. So just hold on a minute. Okay, so we were talking about the reactance X, right? So we need to plot this with respect to frequencies, difference of these two. So at low frequencies, this value is minus infinity. And high frequencies, this value is plus infinity. So as we increase the frequency from lower value, at some point, what is XL minus XC? XL minus XC. That means we are adding these two waveforms. This is XL plus minus of XC. So adding these two waveforms, you can see here. At some point, you will get zero here. Because XL plus minus XC, they both are becoming equal here. So sum of these two will be equal to zero. And after that, again, it will increase. So if I'm drawing here, this graph with another color, X, okay, X. Then how will this be? What will be the variation of this? XL plus minus of XC. Right, you will get here the difference. Initial value will be very, very small, very, very negative here, minus infinity. It will become plus. It will become positive and go to minus, go to plus infinity. So this will be the variation of X. I hope this is clear to everyone. At this point, this becomes zero because XL and XC, they both are equal and they are subtracted. So at this point, F is equal to FR, that is resonant frequency, this is the graph. Now if I ask you to draw what is Z, Z we know that this is R plus J times X, isn't it? And if I ask you to draw the find out the magnitude, this will be nothing but root of R square plus X square, isn't it? This is the magnitude. So to find out the magnitude, have to square x. So what will be square of x? If this is x, then what is x square? If this is the graph of x, what will be x square? Who will tell me? This is a basic mathematics question. Quickly, quickly. Yes, roll number 20, 29, 30. Roll number 56, 48, 41. Who will tell me? First of all, am I audible to all? Yes. So what will be this? The square of this. If x is given to you in this fashion, what will be square of this? Basically, square means whatever the function you have, just square the values. So if you can see here the function is negative, square of that will be positive, but squared with the values. So whatever the values, the shape I wanted to know. So this will be the shape here, like this. And in the positive half, all these values will be squared. Right, so all these values will be squared like this. It will go like this. So this will be x square, right? This will be the graph of x square. Now you know what is x square, right? You have to add r square to it, or any particular value, any value r square to it. What will happen to this? If you add to this x square some constant value, I'm going to add to this another value, okay? And I want to find out what is z in this particular case. So shifting this, what will happen? This x square is getting added up. So x square will be shifted by a resistance value, a constant value upwards, right? So this graph will basically get shifted upwards. So this will become like this. So this will be the magnitude of z, this graph, where z is equal to root of r square plus x square. So at this point we can say what is the total impedance, because this is the impedance graph we are talking about, right? Impedance, we can say before the resonant frequency, the impedance is very, very high. And after the resonant frequency, again, the impedance is very, very high. At resonant frequency, the impedance value at a resonance condition at f is equal to fr is equal to its minimum value. And what is its minimum value? That is when x becomes equal to 0, that is equal to r. Isn't it? At resonance, we know z is equal to r because x is equal to 0. So this is the impedance variation at resonance condition. Now, if you know what is the impedance, can you tell me what will be the current? If I ask you what is the plot of current with respect to frequency, we know that V is equal to I into z. And the magnitude of this Vs will be equal to magnitude of I multiplied by magnitude of z. So if you know the voltage, this is fixed. And if you know the variation in z, what will be the variation in I? Just the inverse of that. That means whenever, what is I? I is nothing but Vs divided by z. When z is maximum, I will be minimum. Okay. And when z is minimum, I will be maximum. So I can say that my graph of I will be just opposite to it. That means at this point, at resonance condition, my current in the circuit will be maximum, and the other case is when z is maximum. Here z is maximum, so current will be minimum. Here again, in this particular case, z is becoming maximum, so the current will be becoming minimum. So current, I can say that this will be equal to I max when z equal to z min. Okay, these both are the same points, that is the resonance condition. So whenever you say that current and voltage, they both are in same phase, we had written here, right? They both are in phase, same phase. Also, during resonance, the current to the circuit is equal to its maximum value. And what is the maximum value? If I ask you what is the maximum value of current here, the current value is equal to its maximum value, which is equal to Vs divided by R. Why? Because Z is equal to R, so I is equal to Vs divided by R. I hope that is clear. So this is the complete analysis of your series resonant circuit. Okay, only basic graphs would have been shown in your lab manual and all other places. This is the mathematical approach which I generally use so that you understand what are we actually plotting here. So all these graphs are very important to have a basic understanding of phasor diagrams and variation of inductive reactance, capacitive reactance with respect to the frequency of operation. Fine. So that is about series resonance condition. So now we have two graphs with us. Okay. So let me just draw that graph. One graph, we know this is the very important graph, Z versus F. And how is the variation? We know that the variation of Z versus F is something like this. And this is the resonant frequency. And what is the value of Z at this point? Z is equal to R. It is its minimum value. Similarly, the other graph, which is very important, is the variation of current with respect to frequency. So at this peak point, at this point of resonance, current will be at its peak. So current will go like this and we'll get a graph like this. And what is the value of current here? Current value is equal to I max, and that value is equal to Vs divided by R. So these two graphs are the resultant of the whole analysis which we did. Okay. I and Z. These are the most important graphs for resonance condition. So anything below this, what is happening? Your capacitive reactance is greater than inductive reactance. That means it is behaving as a capacitive circuit. And anything greater than resonant frequency, XL will be greater than XC. So that will make it behave as an inductive circuit. Is that clear? So this is about the properties of series resonance circuit. Now, what will be the power factor? Power factor we had seen in the last experiment also. What is power factor? Power factor is the degree to which a given system or a given circuit behaves as a pure resistance, isn't it? So we have cos phi from the triangle. Remember the triangle here. What is this triangle value? This is Vs, this is VL minus VC, and this is equal to VR or VL plus VC, whatever way you want to write down this, sum of these two phases, and this is equal to Vs. But what is this? This is equal to I into Z, this is equal to I into R, and sum of these two is equal to J times I into X, isn't it? So if I divide all the three sides of this triangle by I, because I can say I is all everywhere, then I will get this triangle here like this, whose sides are Z, R and X. Z, R and X. This is the angle phi. So what is cos phi here? Cos phi is nothing but R divided by Z. Where what is Z? Root of R square plus X square. This is the general phasor diagram. And this triangle, you can see, what is it representing? It is representing Z is equal to R plus J times X. So this triangle is known as an impedance triangle. Impedance triangle. Impedance Z is equal to R plus J times X, where Z is, what is the magnitude of Z? Root of R square plus X square. Now at resonance condition, we need to find out what is power factor. Power factor at resonance condition, what will happen? Z is equal to R. So R divided by R, this will become equal to 1. So power factor at resonance condition is equal to unity. Okay, the power factor at resonance condition is equal to unity. I hope this is clear to everyone. Please confirm whether this is clear to all.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. So now let me just quickly go to that slide here. And the three theories explained. So whatever I've explained, it is put in the slide also. So this is the series resonance condition. We have current and voltage in phase. For an inductor, current is lagging the voltage by 90 degree. Here the current is leading the voltage by 90 degree. And this is for a RLC parallel resonant. This I will discuss in some time. Now XL with respect to frequency, we have already seen the theories, or the theory you can read later. It is a linear variation of XL with respect to F, straight line passing through the origin. Similarly, capacitive reactance, we have seen this is 1 by 2 pi FC. So a rectangular hyperbola. And XL minus XC, we can see that at resonance condition, they both are equal. So what is the resonant frequency? 1 by root times LC. Now impedance we had plotted separately, we are using mathematics, we had plotted graphs, right? So this is the variation of Z with respect to F. I told you, for lower frequencies, lesser than the resonant frequency, we have capacitive nature, above which we have inductive nature. So this slide will also be shared with you on LMS. It is already there on LMS. If you people are added to this course, you people can access this slide. And this is the circuit here. And the current, I told you, the second graph is current with respect to the frequency. So the current graph is something like this. Okay, increasing and then decreasing at resonance condition. And what is the current? The peak value of current is V divided by R. Fine. Now, the phase angle of circuit, what is happening to the phase angle? You can see this voltage and the second one is current. So at resonance condition, they both are in same phase. This is when they both are in resonance, when the circuit is in resonance. If it is a capacitive circuit, you can see that current will be leading the voltage, making it a capacitive circuit. XC is greater than XL. And here XL is greater than XC, making it an inductive circuit, making the current theta, current I, lag the voltage by some angle theta here. Lagging the voltage. So that same graph, this theta, this is the graph of theta. Theta is the angle between current and voltage. That phase is given here. So at resonance, that theta is zero here. Both are in same phase. For greater value of frequency, it is positive. You can see it is positive. And for lesser values of frequencies in this side, it is becoming negative. It is becoming negative. Fine. Now, there is something which you have to study. What do you mean by the bandwidth of a series RLC circuit? Okay, bandwidth of a series RLC circuit. What is bandwidth? So let me just quickly tell you the graph which we had here. So we had this graph. This is I versus frequency. And the graph is coming out to be something like this. And this is your peak value. Current peak value is Vs divided by R at this point. Now, what is bandwidth? Bandwidth of this circuit, a series resonant circuit. So at this peak current condition, I is equal to I at resonance condition is equal to I max, and its value is equal to Vs divided by R. Right? This is the resonance condition. resonant frequency, FR. Now, if current is maximum in a given circuit, what about the power? The power will also be maximum because power is nothing but I square times R, isn't it? So the power will also be maximum here because I is maximum at resonance. And what is the, this is the maximum power value I square times R, the peak power here. What happens if we move away from this, if we move away from this resonant point in either direction? You can see that current value reduces. If current value reduces, correspondingly power value will also, because power is I square times R. At resonance it is maximum, but either side of resonance, as we decrease the frequency or increase the frequency, this current value reduces. If current reduces, square of that value, by square of that value, the power will also reduce, isn't it? So if the maximum power is at this point, there will be some points at which, if we move away from this resonant point, we'll get a power which is exactly equal to half of Pmax. Half of Pmax. If we move away from this, we know that power is getting reduced, isn't it? So at some point, we will get some power where power is exactly becoming half of this peak value, Pmax. So those points are known as, the frequencies at which this happens are known as half power frequencies. These are known as half power frequencies. So even though the Pmax power, the frequency value is FR, if we go either side, we can say that, let's say this point is the point at which power is becoming Pmax by 2. Okay, at these two points. So we know that there are two frequencies at which this is happening. Let me call that frequency, the lower frequency here, okay? So the lower frequency, I am calling here as FL, or yeah, FL, lower cutoff frequency, and the higher frequency as FH, higher frequency. At two frequencies, you can see that we'll have the same amount of power, which is exactly half of Pmax. How to find out these frequencies? So to find out these frequencies, we can use the same condition. P is exactly half of Pmax. And what is P? P is nothing but I square times the impedance value. Right, this should be equal to half of I max square times the impedance value, isn't it? Now, if that is the case, I multiply 2 to this side, this becomes 2 times I square into Z is equal to I max square into Z here. That means, what is I value? I value becomes equal to I max by root 2. I max by root 2. That means at these points, lower and higher cutoff frequencies, for the power to become half, the current has to become 1 by root 2. So the current values become here 1 by root 2, how much is 1 by root 2? That is 0.707 times Imax. Or I can say that this is 70.7% of Imax. So this is nothing but these two points are 0.707 times Imax. Okay, so we call it half power frequencies, where the current is actually reducing to 70.7% of its maximum or peak value. And these, the width of frequencies or the range of frequencies between this, okay, so I'll just use another color here. So the range of frequencies on either side of this till FL and FH, this range of frequencies is known as the bandwidth of your circuit. So what is bandwidth? Bandwidth is the difference of FH minus FL. right? This difference here between these two. So this FH minus FL is actually the bandwidth of the given circuit. FH minus FL. I hope that is clear. The bandwidth of the circuit. Now, there is something which is known as the quality factor of the circuit. So you can see here, this is the bandwidth and 0.707 Imax. So if you just zoom it, you can see here 0.0707 times the peak value, the current is there. So this range of frequencies is known as bandwidth, and the FL is nothing but the lower cutoff frequency. FH is the upper cutoff frequency. Now there is a term which is known as quality factor. What is quality factor? So the sharpness of the resonance curve is actually represented in terms of quality factor. Sharpness means how sharp this curve is. More sharp this curve, lesser will be the bandwidth, right? Sharper means this distance will be lower. Okay, so the sharpness of the peak is measured in terms of quality factor Q of the circuit. So what does it tell? This quality factor relates to the maximum or peak energy stored in the circuit to the energy dissipated in the resistance during each cycle of oscillation. So basically Q is nothing but FR divided by bandwidth. Q or quality factor of any circuit is nothing but the frequency of resonance divided by the bandwidth of the circuit. So more, if I say that you are having a curve like this, okay, another curve is something like this. Another curve is like this. So I'll say that this third curve is having the highest quality value. Why? Because it is having the minimum bandwidth. That means it's, you can say that it is very much selective in nature. There is something which is known as selectivity also. Okay, so the bandwidth is taken between this 2-3 dB points. What is the 3 dB point? So this point which we have taken here, these points are known as minus 3 dB. This is also minus 3 dB point. dB, when I say decibels, this, if this is 0 decibels, then this is at minus 3 decibel. Okay, these are known as minus 3 dB points. 0.707 is the value there. So that is in the logarithmic scale. We'll study that portion in your theory lecture portion also. So I'm not going to that. So bandwidth is the difference between these two, FH and FL. The selectivity is the measure of its ability to reject any other frequencies either side of these points. So a more selective circuit will be a narrower bandwidth circuit, and a lesser selective circuit will be a wider bandwidth circuit. Okay. So if it is very narrow, that means it's having higher quality, lower bandwidth, that means it is highly selective. First, the most wide one is basically least selective and having high bandwidth. So the quality of the system depends upon lower bandwidth and higher frequency here. So this is the Q factor or the quality factor of your resonant circuit. Now quality factor also can be written in terms of inductive reactance XL divided by R. This is also written as XC divided by R. That makes, this is equal to omega L divided by R, or it is also known as 1 by omega C into R. Okay, this is the quality factor definition. And FR, we know that this is the resonant frequency, frequency of resonance. And some more formulae are there. I'll just go to the next slide here. Yeah. So bandwidth, you can see here. This is when the resistance will be very high, the current will be very less. When resistance is medium, current will be medium. when resistance is very small, current will have a peak, because we know that current is V divided by R, right? So if R is small, current will be very, very high. So variation of X with respect to frequency, variation of this current with respect to R is shown in this particular case. Now, these are the equations you can see for series resonant circuit. At half power frequency, the power is half. I is Im by root 2, right? So, and bandwidth is nothing but FR divided by Q, where what is FH and FL? Okay, so let me just show you that. At resonance condition, okay, here itself we can see, at this condition, P max divided by 2 is the power, and I is equal to I max by root 2. Isn't it? And that means, what is Z here? If I max, I is I max by root 2, then what is happening to Z? This is Z at resonance condition. Okay. And this is at normal half power frequencies. So, what is Z basically? Z is nothing but R plus J times X. That is equal to R plus J times XL is nothing but omega into L minus 1 by omega into C. This is Z. Z value. So R plus J times omega L minus 1 by omega C. Right? We have to find out the values of FL and FH. Isn't it? Now to find out these values, we know that at resonance condition, at FR, we know that Z is equal to R. And at half power frequencies, I'm calling HPF, half power frequencies, Z will be equal to how much? If current becomes I by root 2, then Z becomes root 2 times, isn't it? If I'm talking about Z, then that will become root 2 times. Current is getting reduced by root 2, isn't it? Then Z is becoming root 2 times. So I can say that Z becomes, from this equation, from, I'll just write down here, power at half power frequencies is equal to half of power of resonant frequency. Right? Now, that leads to current at half power frequencies becoming 1 by root 2 times I at resonant frequency. Right? That leads to, because we know that I is equal to V divided by Z. So if I has reduced to 1 by root 2, that means Z has increased by root 2 times. So that makes Z at half power frequencies would be equal to root 2 times the Z at resonant frequency. What is Z at resonant frequency? You know that Z at resonant frequency is equal to R. So Z at half power frequency is actually equal to root 2 times R. So at half power frequency, Z is equal to root 2 times R. Now, but what is Z? Z magnitude is equal to root of R square plus omega L minus 1 by omega C, the whole square. Isn't it? Now, this value is coming out to be how much? Root 2 times R at half power frequencies. So if I square on both the sides, what we will get? If we square on both sides, we will get, this is 2 times R square is equal to, right hand side is R square plus omega L minus 1 by omega C, the whole square. R square, if I take here, 2 R square minus R square is R square. is equal to omega L minus 1 by omega C the whole square. Right? So I write down here omega L minus 1 by omega C is equal to plus or minus R. Right? So if I take on the other side, what you'll get is becomes omega L minus R or minus plus R if on the other side minus 1 by omega C is equal to 0. And if I take the LCM, what you'll get? Omega square into LC minus or minus plus, what you'll get here is RC omega minus 1 should be equal to 0. Isn't it? So what will be omega here? Omega square, I can write down this as omega square. If I divide throughout by LC, you will get minus plus, you will get R by L into omega minus 1 by LC should be equal to 0. So that tells us that there is, it's a quadratic in omega, right? So what will be the value of this? So I'm going to go to the slide. So you can see here, this comes out to be minus R by 2L root of R by 2L whole square plus 1 by LC. This is the lower cutoff frequency and the upper cutoff frequency is plus, right? So if I write down this equation here, what you'll get? Omega is equal to minus B. So minus of B is R divided by L plus minus root of, okay, plus root of B is nothing but R by L whole square minus into minuses plus 4 divided by LC divided by 2. Isn't it? So what will be this term coming out to be? So this comes out to be R by 2L, if I take this 2, plus this 2 gets inside this as 4. Isn't it? So what will be the term we are getting here? Root of, how much is the term here? R by 2L whole square plus 1 by LC. So if I take 4 common here outside, okay, if I take 4 common, then outside it will come as 2 divided by this 2, this denominator 2, and what will be this? 4 I am taking common, that means 4 I have to divide it also. So I'll write down this as R by 2L whole square plus 1 by LC. Okay, so this is your omega 1 or omega L. To find out what is omega H, you have to take the second term. That means this term. So minus, right? So next minus of B here, we take plus. So in that case, you will get here how much? So for lower, we take minus. Okay. For lower, we are taking here minus. And for upper, we are taking plus R by 2L plus same value will come out to be here. How much? Root of R by 2L whole square plus 1 by L. So this is the higher cutoff frequency and this is the lower cutoff frequency. Omega terms. Again, you can write down this as 2 pi F L. This can be written as 2 pi F H. So you can write down in terms of F L and F H also. Okay. So if I find out the difference, because what is bandwidth? Bandwidth is difference between these two. So omega H minus omega L. That means difference of these two. So if I if I subtract these two, what will I get? R by 2L, this term minus this term, minus of minus R by 2L. Because these two terms are exactly the same. 2, 2 is cancelled here. They will get cancelled out. So this comes out to be R by L. And if I write down, this is omega, right? If I write down in terms of, this is nothing but 2 pi FH minus 2 pi FL. Right? This is equal to R by L. So what is FH minus FL in frequency in hertz? This will be nothing but R divided by 2 pi L. R divided by 2 pi L. So I can say that bandwidth in radians is equal to R divided by L, and bandwidth in hertz is equal to R by 2 pi L. Is it clear to everyone? So this is the derivation of this. The derivation is not mentioned in this slide. That is why I have derived this. Only the final result is given, m omega L and omega H. So you can find out this value. So quality factor we had seen. What is quality factor? Quality factor is omega into L divided by R. Omega means omega is at resonance. This is nothing but 1 by omega C into R. And at resonance condition, omega R, this is omega R, okay? Omega R means resonant frequency is nothing but 1 by root LC. If frequency FR we are writing, then 1 by 2 pi will come, root LC. Omega terms, you won't get any 2 pi term. So if you substitute omega value here, that is 1 by root LC into L divided by R. So this gets cancelled, you'll get 1 by R root L by C. So Q is equal to omega R L by R is equal to 1 by omega R into C into R is equal to 1 by R root of L by C. This is the quality factor of your circuit. I hope that is clear. Fine. Now, this is regarding your series resonance experiment. Now, let us quickly see what you have to do in the experiment. Okay. So, I'm going to open the manual here. So this is the lab manual to plot and analyze resonance curve of RLC series AC circuit. The theory is given here. You can read whatever I've explained. This is very basic, which is mentioned here. We have explained and discussed it in detail, all the phasor diagrams and everything. So let us come back here and see the procedure. Okay. So procedure is to connect the circuit as per the circuit diagram. What is the circuit diagram? We have already seen the circuit diagram. We are having R. This is L and this is C, right? They all are connected in series, and this system is connected with an AC source. This AC source is having VS magnitude and frequency is a variable source. So for this AC source, we are not having a 50 Hertz frequency source. Okay. Instead of this, we are connecting, instead of this source, AC source, we are connecting a function generator. A function generator. Now, what is a function generator? You might have studied in your electrical workshop. If not, you will study in your electrical workshop shortly. In experiment number 3, I think. 3 or 4. Yeah, I think 3. Okay, in that particular case, function generator is a instrument. Okay, you can say it's a device which can generate various waveforms. So it can generate sinusoidal waveforms. It can generate triangular waveforms. Sawtooth waveforms, okay, triangular waveforms, square waveforms like this, and so on. So it can generate various waveforms as per the frequency as well as amplitude value. So what we are going to use here is a function generator which provides us a sinusoidal signal with a variable frequency option. That means we can vary the frequency. So the frequency can be increased like this and so on, or it can be decreased. Decrease means time period will be more like this. So frequency can be varied on the signal using the function generator. We are not going to use a single phase AC supply. We are using a variable function generator to excite the RLC series circuit. That will make the frequency for this to be variable. And we'll vary the frequency here because frequency is variable. And we'll see that in this circuit, we are connecting an ammeter. And we know that at resonance condition, what happens to the current? The current becomes maximum. So we'll vary the frequency and we'll see that in this circuit, current slowly is very small initially, it increases. After some point, if we keep on increasing the frequency, the current will start falling down. So the point at which it is becoming maximum, that will be your resonant frequency. Okay, that is what we are going to do in the lab. So you can see this is the, not this. Connect the circuit as per the circuit diagram I have shown. Set the suitable values of parameters and switch on the supply. You adjust the minimum frequency of the supply and increase the frequency and note down the various readings. Okay. Continue to increase the frequency for taking readings until current increases to a maximum value and starts decreasing. So here we are having two options. Okay. So let me go further here. Yeah. So this is the kit actually, in the kit in which we are actually doing the experiment. Okay, so we are having two options. We are having options for C, L and R. We can vary the value of R, L and C to the given values here. R also can be varied to given values, 50 milliohm. This is inductor, 100 milliohm, 150 milliohm. Similarly, capacitor can be 0.01, 0.001 microfarad, 0.002 and so on. So L, C and R all can be varied and they all are connected internally in series. And there is a ammeter which we are having here. This is a milliamp ammeter because current will be in milliamperes here. And this input, we are connecting it to a function generator, sinusoidal voltage with a variable frequency, right? So what is the values? For the case one, we are having R is equal to 10 ohm. Capacitor is, this is what we have selected. In this, we have selected 10 ohm, 10 E. 510 ohms, 1K5. 1K5 means 1 kilo ohm. Okay. Similarly, capacitor we are setting at 0.001 and so on. Inductance is 50 milliampere. So for that, we vary the frequency of your function generator and check the current in the meter. So you can see here what happens. If we increase the frequency here, as we increase frequency, current is increasing. Right, current increases and reaches to a maximum value. What is the maximum value of current? 10.12 milliamperes. After which, again, if we increase the frequency, the current starts decreasing. So we can say that at this point, we can say that series resonance phenomena has taken place. Okay, and case number two, what we are doing, resistance is kept same. Capacitor we have made 0.002 microfarad. Inductance also we have increased. So inductance and capacitors have been doubled here. Now we are checking again. Frequency we are varying in the function generator and we are measuring the current. So you can see here current initially increases. And at this point you can see current is reaching its peak. At 10.45 kilohertz, it is reaching its peak and falling down. So what you have to do, you have to, in graph paper, you have to draw the graph of current versus frequency, not frequency versus current, not this. Okay. You have to draw the graph of current versus frequency for both the cases. For case one, you will get, case two also you will get on the same graph paper. Okay. On the same graph paper, you have to draw. So this is frequency versus current. This is not correct. This is current versus frequency. Just the opposite. Because y-axis versus x-axis. Always we draw the graph like this. And you can conclude, write down the conclusion that for both the cases, what is the resonant frequency and what is the current during resonance condition. For both cases, you have to write down. So you can take this manual will be, I will upload that also in your Google Drive. Also, it is available on LMS. You can download it from there also. Okay, so this is the observation table for both the cases. You can take these values and plot the graph and write down the conclusion. There are some quiz questions also that you can answer. Now I'm going to share with you, I'll play a video right now. Okay, everyone, please watch that video. That video link will also be given to you in your Google Drive. So in case you are unable to watch right now, later also you can watch it by downloading it from the Google Drive. So let me just open that and play that video right now. Okay, so let me share it. Okay, can you verify whether this video is visible to everyone? Is the video is visible? I'm going to play it. Let me know
yes,
if you are able to hear it also.
We are performing the experiment to plot the resonance for a series.
Is the voice reaching you?
Okay. Yes, sir.
Fine.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So I'll just start it from the beginning.
We are performing the experiment to plot the resonance for a series RLC circuit. Okay, so these are the devices or apparatus which are which we are going to use in this experiment. So this is
our
function
generator.
And this is the power of the multimeter. Now I am showing you the connections for this experiment setup. So this is our function generator. So I am connecting this cable to this generator here. This is the output port. I am connecting this cable here. Now you can see this is the cable having two clips here. So one is for return path, one is to give the live line to this kit. You can use any of this wire in line and return path. So this is our multimeter. So this is functioning like an ammeter. So ammeter we are connecting in series. So one terminal of ammeter we are connecting to this. This is a terminal for return path. So I'm connecting this return path of this function generator. this is all about the connections. Now, students, before performing this experiment, I want to let you know the basic concept behind the resonance series RLC. So you can see here, this is the series RLC circuit. And it is connected to the AC power supply, which is 230 150 hertz. You can see here I current is flowing in the circuit. This is the series current and this is the voltage drop across RL and C. So what is the resonance? Resonance is the phenomena, or it is a condition in a series resonance is a phenomena or a condition in series RLC circuit occurs at certain frequency value, which that frequency is called the resonant frequency, and at this frequency your circuit XL, that is the inductive reactance of the circuit, will be equal to the capacitive reactance of the circuit. So, if this XL is equal to XC, your impedance of the circuit, that is Z, will be minimum. And your maximum current will be flowing in the circuit. So, to perform this experiment, you need to make the connections that I already discussed or shown. And after doing the connections, we will on the supply and adjust this function generator to the sine function, and we will adjust the frequency from this 1.5 kHz. We will adjust the frequency at this 1.5 kHz approximately. Then we will vary this frequency using this knob, and we will move it very slowly because this is very sensitive device. So we will move it very slowly, and we will vary this frequency till the current reaches its maximum position. And after that also we will continue to increase this frequency, and we will observe that current is decreasing. So like this, you will observe that you will get the resonance curve. You will first, your current will increase and then it will decrease. So you will note down the frequency at which you will get it. You are getting the maximum current. Okay, that is your resonance frequency. And you can draw your curves, resonance curve. By the readings, you will note down by varying this frequency. Okay. Now, students, we will take the readings for this experiment. So you can see here the observation table. We will take readings for two cases. In case one, we will adjust the capacitance to 0.001 microfarad and inductance to 50 mH. And in case two, we will adjust the capacitance to 0.02 microfarad and inductance to 100 mH. Then we will take, we will vary the frequency, and we will note down the corresponding current in this multimeter. Now students start varying the frequency using this knob. Move it very slowly, and you can observe the current. So right now the frequency is 1.57 kHz and corresponding current is 0.004. Now I am increasing this frequency. You can observe at 2.6 kHz you are getting 0.607 mA current. Again I am increasing the frequency. If my frequency is 5.84 kHz, then the current is 0.13. It is increasing continuously. You can observe this. Now you can observe here at the frequency 21.98 kilohertz, our current is 9.76. Now I am increasing this frequency. The current is going to start decreasing. Okay, so at 22.31 you can observe current is going to decrease. Now if I am increasing frequency after this, current is still decreasing. You will draw the resonance curve and we noted down the maximum frequency value at which the current in the circuit is reaching the maximum value. So that frequency value is called the resonance frequency of the circuit. So students, you can see we took the readings for the case 1 of this experiment. In case 1 we took R equals 10 ohm, L equals to 50 millihenry, C equals to 0.001 microfarad. So you can see here, we took the readings and first our current is increasing and it is increasing till this frequency, which is 21.88 kilohertz. So after this frequency, you can observe our current is decreasing. So this frequency at which the current is maximum, 10.12 milliampere, this frequency is called the resonance frequency. Now students, we will take the readings for the case 2. In case 2, the resistance, we will change the value of inductor and capacitor. So we will change the value of inductor from here. We will move this knob to 100 millihenry and the capacitor value will be changed to 0.002 microfarad. And again we will follow the same procedure and we will start increasing the frequency gradually using this knob. And you can note down the corresponding current reading from this multimeter. And can observe the resonance frequency value. You can see if we are increasing the frequency, current is increasing. And after some point, current will start decreasing. So you have to note down all the readings. Similarly, like case 1. So students, you can see we took the readings for case 2. In case 2, our R is 10 ohm, L is 100 milliampere, C is 0.002 microfarad. So in this case, first we increase the frequency gradually. So you can observe here that our current is continuously increasing till this point. 10.53 kilohertz, we are getting the current 12.21 milliampere. So this is our resonance frequency, because after this frequency the current starts decreasing. So at this frequency we are getting the maximum current. So this is our resonance frequency. Now students, you can plot the two graphs for these two cases. Okay, so the graph will be frequency versus current. You can separately draw the two graphs. First you will draw for case 1 and then for case 2.
Yes, so students, I hope you watched the video properly and this was clear to you how we are doing in the lab. Okay, so that is about our experiment number 3 of resonance. You have to write down, draw, take these observation table values. You can take a snapshot if you want right now. This is for case number 1. Okay, and this is for case number 2. Let me just reduce this thing. So case number 2, if you want, you can take the snapshot. Anyways, I will be sharing this, my lecture recording also, as well as this manual. Everything will be shared with you. Okay, so go through it, and if you want, I can share with you this notes also, if you want.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, fine. So please complete. I think you people are able to access. I have already shared with you the previous lecture recordings also. Are you people able to access it? The Google Drive?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So
yes, sir.
Material, okay. Make use of this lecture recordings, everything which is being provided to you, because don't wait that later on you will watch it and then you will do. You are not going to get the time, because in Nirvana University you won't get time to just think and do later. Whatever is coming, finish that work now, otherwise you will suffer in the end. Okay, so complete your lab records also and submit it as per the due dates mentioned on the LMS portal. Everyone is able to access LMS now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So in that, if I just share with you the screen. Okay. And if I go to the course material here, you can see here, this is your Tetrae course. So in that you can see this is experiment number 1, 2, 3, and 4. Okay. So 4 experiments are already uploaded there. In this is the 3rd experiment. If you click on this, you will get this resonant circuit PDF. This is the lab manual and this is the PPT, the first PPT which I was discussing. Okay, so these both are available already. If you want, I will add this in the Google Drive folder also, in case if someone is having difficulty in accessing the LMS. Okay, so that is about your experiment number 3. Complete the sessions. Okay, so due date here as of now is mentioned 11 December. So finish everything before this date. Okay, and experiment number 1, 2. Okay, for all, I think, yeah, this is 26 November. So this is to be finished first now. 26 November. Okay, experiment number 2, aap logon ko 26 November tak finish karna hai. 1 and 2. And 1 is also having a date. Let me just tell you. Experiment number 1. The date was, again, this is also 26th. So for experiment number 1 and 2, date is 26th November. For experiment number 3, the date is 11th December. So please complete everything in due, within the due date. All experiments, if you see, the lab manuals will be given to you. You can access it from the same. Fine. So that is all for today. You people, please access LMS and complete your lab submissions in time. In case you people have any doubts, you can contact me via email, and in the next session also you can ask if there is any discussion required. So next week we will have experiment number 4. Fine, you all can leave the meeting now.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.